Ashat Audio presents Yes Ma'am, No Sir, The 12 Essential Steps for Success in Life, written by Coach Carter, read by Vince Bailey. Author's Note, Introduction, and Coach Carter Carrots, read by the author.
This audiobook is dedicated to my parents, the late A.J. Carter Sr. and my mother, Hetty Lee Carter. Author's Note. I love to learn. It doesn't matter what subject you're talking about. If it's something I don't know, then I want to learn about it. And if it's something I already know about, then I want to learn more. I have an insatiable curiosity about all forms of human behavior and about life in general. Everything in this world fills me with wonder. That's exactly what happened when I picked up a pen to write this audiobook. I couldn't put it down because when I went to work on this audiobook, it went to work on me. I learned something from every sentence. If you're in possession of this audiobook, I consider you a part of my team. And as part of my team, it is crucial that you win. So listen to this audiobook. Pick it apart and take notes, because this is the playbook to success in your life. Introduction. Long before I became Coach Carter of Hollywood recognition, portrayed in a blockbuster film by Mr. Samuel Jackson, I was Kenny Ray Carter, a boy who watched his parents tirelessly raise 9 kids on a farm in rural Mississippi. As it turned out, it was the perfect backdrop to an inspired life that has become a touchstone of limitless possibilities and success. I was too young to see that then. Instead, I wondered, why do we seem to have less than others? We were not poor. We were broke. Being broke is just an economic condition. But being poor is a disabling frame of mind and a depressed condition of the human spirit. So we were never, ever depressed. We were just broke. I tell people that my family was so broke that when we rode by the bank, we set off the alarm. The reality, I came to understand, was that even though we were broke, we had much more than most. More love, support, and togetherness. And those elements sustained us and helped shape me into the man of honor, commitment, and achievement. It was a long journey that started when I was a kid. Seeing my parents work hard to provide for us instilled a dogged work ethic in me that showed when I was just 7 years old, and it still resides in me today. At that young age, I started my first business. I placed small, undeveloped cucumbers inside long-neck bottles and waited until they grew so they could not come out. It made people wonder how I got that big cucumber through that narrow bottleneck. I loaded up my unique novelties into my little red wagon, and with no shoes or shirt, I headed into town to set up shop. I sold them for $5. If someone had a $10 bill, I never gave change. Instead, I sold him too. I just had no fear. And I ended up making more in a day than my mom and dad. That was where my road to being a leader began. Years later, when our family moved across the country to Richmond, California, I carried that spirit of ownership and leadership with me. The day we arrived in Richmond was March 19, 1972. I remember that day so well all these years later because so much happened. We were excited about moving into a home with running water. In Mississippi, I had to pump water from a well. Also, that was the day I met Mr. James Dunkley. He owned a laundromat in Richmond. And that first day, I saw him dump hundreds of quarters from the washers and dryers into a large bucket. Back in Mississippi, if you had a quarter, you had wealth. And here was a man with hundreds of them. I was only 12, but I could not resist asking Mr. Dunkley, "Are all those quarters yours?" He told me they were, and that he emptied the machines twice a week. Well, I was amazed. That made a real impression on me, but not as much as what Mr. Dunkley said to me that day. You can make a life for yourself working for others. You can create a lifestyle if you work for yourself. Powerful. That stuck with me, and it is one of the principles I carry with me today. In one sense, Mr. Dunkley meant that it was important to have leadership over your own life, to take command of it. Too often, I have found that most people don't know how to do that. They get set into a mundane routine and exist instead of creating a winning lifestyle for themselves. I play to win. I am not talking about just basketball. My name and some of my story are familiar because of the motion picture that depicted an integral part of my life. But what I accomplished with the young men on the Richmond High basketball team were far more important than just the results of the games. Those results were extremely important. You played a game to win. And we were so adamant about it that I never kept any second place trophies we received. But the bigger and most important part of that experience was the teaching of leadership and discipline, self-pride, and work ethic. Those are the character traits that had to be built up as we went on our basketball journey. They call me Coach Carter, but I call myself a teacher. A coach designs plays and sets up things for a player to do on the court. A teacher explains why you do certain things to get a desired result. My players learned about the game in the fundamentals and how to attack an opponent based on knowing their strengths and weaknesses and understanding basketball. That's not coaching, that's teaching. When I first got there, we had no nets on the goals, no socks, no towels, which didn't really matter because the showers didn't work. But the only thing that bothered me was the boys looked like losers and they acted like losers. So I told them, all that changes today. Winning in here is the same as winning out there in life. If you take a basketball and hold it over your head and drop it, every time it bounces, it loses 50% of its momentum. That's the way a basketball career is. Every year, someone comes behind you a little stronger, a little faster, and a little hungrier. Every shot you take, you're getting closer to the end of your career. But hopefully, you're getting a little bit smarter. You want to talk numbers? Only one in every 500,000 people get an opportunity to play any type of professional sports. So it's okay to put all your eggs in one basket if it's the family business and you have control of it, but not in becoming a professional player. And that's how we went about our business. I owned a sporting goods store, a t-shirt printing company, and four barbershops. They were all run professionally, as a business should be run. And I ran my basketball team as a business too. The business was about winning and making sure those kids were prepared to win in life. That mindset developed for me unusually early in life. For most, it comes much later, if at all. And that's where this audiobook comes in. Through sharing my life experiences and the philosophies I developed through them, I will impart invaluable nuggets to maximize the winner in you so you too can gain or reinforce leadership over your life. This will be a journey that brings home the importance of taking ownership of your life to live a valued life of achievement, respect, and gratification. Now, I would like to turn you over to Mr. Vince Bailey, the voice, who will take you through the chapters of this audiobook. And I will return throughout this audiobook to give you personal tips and stories that I call Coach Carter Carrots.
Chapter 1, Why Leadership Matters. It was a surreal feeling to see part of my life played out on celluloid in the 2005 motion picture Coach Carter. The feelings from those years came rushing back like water over a breach levee. With every scene, a sense of pride and accomplishment covered my body. The apex of the movie, in particular, brought me right back to the emotions of that time and place. I locked out my Richmond High basketball team from the gymnasium, causing much upheaval. We just so happened to be the top-ranked team in 1999 in California at the time, making my decision all the more dramatic. The reason I went to such an extreme measure? Not all the players were maintaining a 2.3 grade point average. As a former athlete, I knew how much they lived for game day. It was everything, but I locked them out because, as their leader, I had to make them understand that what they did in the classroom was more important than on the basketball court. I had given them a contract that called for them to maintain a 2.3 GPA, to attend all their classes, to sit in the front of the classroom, and to wear a white shirt and tie to school on every game day, among other edicts. They signed it, meaning they were bound by it. My academic challenge was significant in this way. To get into college with a 2.0 GPA, the students would have been required to score 850 on the SAT. With a 2.3, the requirement on the SAT was about 100 points less. And because scoring more on the SAT is harder than raising your GPA in school, it made sense to me to make that a contractual goal for the players. But some of the players basked too brightly in our 13-0 record, and their grades dropped. When I received the progress reports, I was devastated. The team's play had galvanized the school and the community, but I was also...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.